Thank you, Kristen. That was beautiful. Good morning on this almost last day of October, and welcome to worship here at St. Paul's United Church of Christ, located in Crystal Lake, Illinois. Whether you are joining us today in person or online through our live stream service, we welcome you and wish you a blessed day. My name is Jane Dawson, and I will be sharing a few announcements before we begin our worship this morning. The beautiful flowers have been provided by the Kattenhusen family in loving memory of their mom, Ginny Kattenhusen, and I love the frog on the bouquet. Offerings can be placed in the collection plate located on the table outside the sanctuary doors, or you can use the QR code in the service bulletin to make an online donation. If you prefer to mail in your offering, our mailing address can be found on our church's website at www.stpaulsucc-cl.org. That's www.stpaulsucc-cl.org. On the first Sunday of each month, we celebrate Holy Communion. That will be next week. We invite you to enjoy coffee and goodies during fellowship hour in the narthex after the service. Please refer to our weekly church chatter for details on how you can volunteer to help with fellowship hour. This Sunday, we have special announcements. First, in my estimation, Trunk or Treat was a wonderful success, and the weather was very nice for it. Our preschool mitten drive is still accepting children's mittens to be hung in front of Becky's office window. She put up a string for this purpose. St. Paul's Church Life Group will be hosting our traditional Thanksgiving supper on Sunday, November 20th, immediately following the 5 p.m. service. If you need transportation, please contact the church office. There will be a sign-up sheet in the narthex, and you can list the dish you plan to bring to share. Turkey, dressing, gravy, and beverages will be provided. Sunday, November 20th is also the date of our annual Community Harvest Food Drive. Please bring your donations for the Crystal Lake Food Pantry. There is a list of suggested items in the October Beacon. Monetary donations are always welcome. Need is high at this time. If you have any thoughts and ideas or would like to be a part of our lounge renovation, we welcome your input. The Giving Tree is now up. Your generous donations will support North School, Pioneer Center, and St. Paul's families. Choose your ornaments from the tree today through December 5th. See Wendy DeManico or Ann Lingner in the narthex to make your donation. Thank you. This concludes our announcements for this morning. Let us begin worship.
Super famous Martin Luther Reformation hymn called A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. Please rise in body or in spirit and let us sing to the Lord.
morning to our youngest Christians. I'm Mr. Cruz, and I'm very happy to be with you here this morning. And so is our good friend, Mr. Oakley. Well, I'd like to share with you this morning that I enjoy singing. Do you enjoy singing? You know, I'm thinking I can't think of anyone who probably doesn't enjoy singing. And if I were to ask you what your favorite song is right now, what would it be? I'm thinking that we would have a different answer from each person answering that question. Isn't that amazing? Why do you think that we all have different favorite songs? Well, probably because they have very special meaning to us, or they remind us of a special time or event in our lives. Or maybe it's just we simply like the tune. It's got a good beat that you can dance to. Well, there are many stories in the Bible of people singing. And we sing in church here on Sundays during worship. We call those songs hymns. Why do you think that the music we hear and sing in church on Sundays is so important to us? Well, I think it's because it's a gift from God, and it makes us very happy. Most of the songs we sing in church are songs of praise. Singing psalms is one of the ways that we can tell God how we feel about him and how happy and glad we are to be his people. And in our Bible verse today, from the book of Colossians, in chapter 3, verse 16, St. Paul is encouraging the people to sing hymns and songs that make them happy and lift their spirits. Paul says, "Let the message of Jesus fill your lives and sing songs to God with gratitude in your hearts." There's an old saying that says, "Music gladdens the heart." Sometimes, when we feel sad or even frightened, singing a song will help lift our spirits and make us feel good again. And it makes a sweet, sweet sound in God's ear. So keep on singing. Will you bow your heads as I say a prayer? Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of Jesus, the gift that fills our hearts with gladness and makes us sing songs of praise and thanks to you. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to this time of prayer here in our service of worship today. We gather before the Lord, bringing to God our prayers, our hopes, our dreams, and all those concerns and joys for which we wish to praise God. This is an opportunity to do so. And in a few minutes, I'll invite you to enter into a time of quiet prayer. And as you pray quietly, I ask, will you remember Clifford and Haley in your prayers, and also the family of Darren Konechny? This next Tuesday will be All Saints Day. And as we have traditionally done here at St. Paul's, we mark All Saints Day, November the 1st, on this Sunday. We do so by remembering in prayer those people that we have prayed for over the past 12 months that have passed from this life to the next. If you look at the back of your bulletin, you'll see names listed. These are the people who have been included on our prayer list over the past 12 months since last year's All Saints Day. I'm going to read these names aloud, And as I do so, I'm going to invite you to stand as you're able, in body or in spirit, as I read these names, and then remain standing for prayer, and then I'll invite you to be seated for quiet prayer and the Lord's Prayer. So first, we remember those saints who have passed during this last year, and I invite you, out of respect and consideration, to please stand as you're able as we read these names. David Anger, Marjorie Burke, Judd Boyer, Mary Jane Butler, Betty Cameron, Robert Chappell, Betty Charles, Judy Conyer, Alan Eslick, Bob Graves, Norm Falk, Grayson, Elizabeth Hannigan, Janet Hannigan, Shirley Huddle, Martha Hughes, Pat Eichelson, Delbert Isley, Laura Jacobson, Jim Johnson, Bruce Collar, Louise Koenig, Carlene Macko, Tom Maternus, Pat Nicholson, Darlene Olson, Brian Prather, Tom Riley, James Roxworthy, Dave Seipt, Bill Skaggs, Craig Starbird, Larry Skipper, John Sroka, Nancy Thompson, Sharon Trainer, Frank Vocalino, Kim Weiss, Larry Winters. As we remain standing, I invite all of you who are here in person, if you have a name you would like to add, would you please speak it aloud, or if you're worshiping with us online, speak it aloud from your home. Will you pray with me? We thank you, God, for the gift of life in this world and for the hope and promise of life to come. We thank you for the precious, precious gift of life. We thank you for this day and the opportunity to remember those who have passed. We thank you again for their influence, for the ties that bind us to them, for our concern, care, and love for them, friendship, family, and in turn, the gifts we have received from them. Thank you, O God, for these people. Once more, we have entrusted them to your care, and we look to the day when we'd be reunited in your presence, where all are healed, all is forgiven, and your love has the final word. Amen. Will you please be seated, and will you join me now in a time of quiet prayer? Will you pray quietly? Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. We believe your steadfast love never ceases, your kindness never comes to an end, and your mercies are new every morning. Great is your love. We're grateful, O God, for all those that you number as your people. We're grateful for your breaking down the walls that divide us, uniting rich and poor, people of all shades, the lame and the spry, the bright and the bland, the loyal and the disloyal. We're grateful that you reconcile all of us through your love in Jesus Christ. We're grateful, O God, for this church. We ask that we continue to be a hospice where all will find shelter, whose doors are opened when others are shut. Let there be no strangers here where Jesus is our host. We're grateful for the opportunity to come together and sing your praises, receive your spirit, and be sent forth with renewed commitment to seek out those whom society has abandoned. Will you help us be quick to recognize their dignity, to affirm others' right to self-determination, and to assist them in their quest for wholeness, the wholeness that we offer through Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior, and who taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. To this end, we have been called by God to serve God's people, to serve God's world with every good resolve and work of faith. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we may offer our gifts that he would be glorified amongst us, and the grace of God would be spread far abroad in our world. Now is a time when we may, if moved by God's Spirit, share the abundance we have received. Will you pray with me again? We are grateful, O God, that you have given us an opportunity to serve the ability and capacity to share. And so we bring you our tributes now. We believe that you are the God who delivers us, and glad praises we sing to you for that fact. All that we have, we thank our gifts of your graciousness. You plumb our potential and our yield increases. We are stewards of your mercy, called to serve. Will you please accept these offerings as signs of our faithfulness throughout each day? Amen.
Amen. Up and dance on the stage, but it's not the comedy hour. Our scripture this morning is Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God.
Thank you, Jane. Thank you, Kristen. Well, in January, it will be 3 years since she passed away. Shirley Irina Murray was 89 when she passed. She was in this life a teacher and the wife of a Presbyterian minister who lived in New Zealand. And she also wrote hymns. In fact, 16 of Shirley Arena Murray's hymns are in our hymnal. And I would like for you to experience a taste of her hymnody. And so, at this time, I don't expect you to know the words, but if you do, you can sing along, because we don't sing these very often. But you are certainly welcome to tap your toe, or hymn, or hum, I'm sorry, or sing along if you know. But Kristen is going to share some of her music with us, a couple of her pieces. Kristen, that was For the Music of Creation, which is number 641 in our hymnal, if you'd like to look it up sometime, and Star Child, number 223, a beautiful, beautiful Christmas hymn. Well, our series continues this morning, 10 Things I Like About the Church. And the topic this morning is, it's music. I really like the church, its music. First, I like that the church has music. Not all religions do. There is a debate within Islam over whether music is forbidden by God. They chant, Muslims do, but they do not sing in worship or play music. Buddhists chant, but this is a form of meditation. They do not sing to God. In fact, of the three great evangelical religions in the world, Christianity, Islam, and Buddhism, Christianity is the only faith that sings. And that's very important to me. Music is vitally important to my experience in worship. I can't imagine worshiping God and not singing. I can't imagine worshiping God and singing well, but I can't imagine worshiping God and not singing. God is, for me, ultimate. Ultimate value, ultimate meaning, ultimate purpose, ultimate power. God is the ultimate in every way. And when I think of the ultimate, I think of that which is inexpressible. And Aldous Huxley said, after silence, that which comes nearest to expressing the inexpressible is music. And we as Christians believe that God is love. This love is revealed to us through Jesus of Nazareth. And Sidney Lanier said, "Music is love in search of a word." So when I come together with you, I love that we have music. And I love that the church has all kinds of music. Bach's Passions, Fanny Crosby's Evangelical Hymns, Gregorian Chants Offered to God, the greatest classical composers, Mozart, Beethoven, Bach, who you may remember was a church organist, composed sacred music for the church. There is this thing that we still call contemporary Christian music, though it's been dated to 1969 as its beginning, so that really makes it vintage, I understand. But names like Michael W. Smith, Amy Grant, Rich Mullins, groups like Casting Crowns, Point of Grace, so many, many contemporary Christian groups. I'm guessing some of you may listen to some of their music driving to and from work on your radio, because there's channels devoted to contemporary Christian music. One contemporary artist is Twyla Paris. Twyla has some hymns in our hymnal. In fact, Kristen's going to share a verse of one of those now.
Your only son.
Twyla Paris is the daughter of a street Pentecostal minister, and her lyrics express her charismatic Assemblies of God background. Now, I saw in researching for this sermon that there's at least one church in California which describes itself as a heavy metal church. It's true. The music is all heavy metal. The pastor, he's heavy metal. He looks like he's heavy metal. And he talks like he's heavy metal. It's a heavy metal church. Now, I don't find all church music as equally appealing to me, though there is almost all ways something I can find that I like. But I do like its diversity, and it amazes me that there is so much difference from church to church in their music. And yet they all have remarkably beautiful music. There's the Church of Christ. We have one just up the street and down a ways. They have music, but no musical instruments. All is a cappella. Then to the Orthodox Church. Everything, including the reading of the scripture, is sung. Now, I love that music is so memorable. It stays with us. And its lyrics, the lyrics can be very influential on our faith. on what we believe. I had a professor in seminary who once said to me, now the people in the church, they will actually take their theology more from the hymnal than the Bible. And I guess, well, perhaps you can tell me, I guess perhaps you might be the best judge of that. Can you quote more lyrics from hymns than you can Bible passages? Now, I have to say, too, that there's a tremendous variety of hymns, and I don't agree with all the theology or ideas presented in hymns. And that's okay, that's natural, right? We don't all agree on everything. That would be unrealistic. So there are some hymns that, even though they're quite popular, I'm not so comfortable singing them because they describe things in ways that don't really fit my thinking. One of the things I love about Shirley Murray's hymns are her lyrics. Absolutely beautiful lyrics. And she uses the Maori tradition, the Maori, the native, the indigenous people to New Zealand, to include that tradition in her lyrics and her hymns. It's remarkable. Yeah. Martin Luther, he understood the value of teaching through hymns. He took, I understand, common beer drinking songs that were found in the beer halls in Germany, and he put Christian ideas to them. And he wrote hymns with them. We sang one of his most famous hymns earlier, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." And the other thing I love about church music is that church music has great stories just behind the songs. I mean, we all probably know, because they made a movie out of it, the story of Amazing Grace, right? Who doesn't know at least some line from Amazing Grace? And I'm sure you probably are familiar with the story behind it, but in case you're not, its author was John Newton. John Newton was a captain of a ship that hauled slaves across the Atlantic Ocean. He was a captain of a slave ship. And then he became a Christian. And he left that way of life behind. And as a Christian, he wrote Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace, how sweet that sound, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. The stories behind the Christian pieces are just astounding. And of course, music evokes within us these personal, powerful experiences, emotions, sensations of joy and happiness and even melancholy, deep feelings to the beat. The toes are tapping. Jane, you should have gotten up and danced. They do that in some churches, right? Because what are they doing? They're not just showing off their dance moves. They are worshiping God with their bodies. With their bodies. And music gives us the beat to do so with. So.
See ya.
Christians gave us this peace, right? But to sing to God this universal experience of wonder and awe, to express in some way beyond our words, our thanksgiving, our gratitude, our appreciation for life and faith and hope and continued providence and provision. Our lives have been blessed. We recognize that just to be here. Our lives have been blessed. We are blessed. And we wish to give thanks to our Maker. And so we sing of God's praise. We say, how great thou art. Music unites us, how it brings us together, not just those of us who are singing or humming or tapping our toes in this place, but to my mind, it brings us together, it unites us with all those who have and are singing and playing this music. It transports us. It transports us from this time and place to another time and place where we coexist with the experience of the music now with another time and another place, and it brings flooding back to us memories and feelings and hopes and dreams and experiences which make life so rich. It unites us with each other in doing so, such as when we sing on Christmas Eve, Silent Night. There's so many things I could say about what I like about the church's music. But one more thing I'll share. I was driving down the street the other day and I saw a bumper sticker on the back of a truck in front of me. And it simply said, "Music is my therapy." Music has a tremendous capacity to calm us. And not just calm us in that settling down, but music has the capacity to attune our souls to hope. I don't know how it works. I don't think it's ever been fully explained as far as my understanding of it has been, but it reassures us. It gives us an opportunity just to center our lives. That is, it is a profoundly spiritual experience. Good music is profoundly a spiritual experience, primarily a spiritual experience. to be able to have our souls ministered to by music, lyrics, and music that help us feel safe and remind us of our hope and give us a sense of real peace, even in the midst of strife. It is always astonishing to me how I can try to think myself out of my feelings and find myself basically battering against a closed wall. But if the right piece of music comes on, or I put the right kind of music on, everything feels right, and those feelings that I so cherish, so want to be a part of my life, are given to me freely by God. That is one of the things I love about the church's music. It brings us God's peace and assurance. So those are some of the things that I really like about the church's music. Those are some of the ways in which God comes very close to me through our music. I could sing when I was in junior high or middle school, but then something happened. But I still enjoy making a noise to the Lord. And I also love hearing you make noise to the Lord. In fact, is there any experience like being in church and hearing people sing? I mean, sing. Is there anything really like that?
And our final hymn for today will be number 529. It is called For All the Saints, in honor of All Saints Day. There's six verses. We are going to do 1, 2, 5, 6. So we're not going to sing all six of them. 1, 2, 5, and 6. If you would please rise in body or in spirit, let's sing 529 to the Lord.
Thank you.
Once more, will you pray? Oh God, you are the God of our salvation. We cried to you for deliverance, and you have answered us. You are the hope of all the ends of the earth and of the farthest seas. By your strength, you establish the mountains and still the waters, and you calm the troubled breasts of all who put their trust in you. We shall not cease to sing your praises and bless your holy name. Amen.